Highbridge, a division of Recorded Books, presents Bad Mexicans, Race, Empire, and Revolution in the Borderlands by Kelly Lytle Hernández, read by Joana Garcia. Introduction. We stand between. They lit the pyre and watched him burn. Antonio Rodriguez, a 20-year-old ranch hand, murdered a white woman, they said. White men from nearby farms formed a posse to track him down, while the other residents of Rock Springs, Texas, some 400 of them, met at the edge of town and piled kindling at the base of a mesquite tree. The posse soon arrived, with a cowboy in the lead, dragging Rodriguez by a lasso looped around his neck. The mob laughed as they chained Antonio to the tree and doused him in kerosene. Someone threw a match, and 30 minutes later, when Antonio Rodriguez was dead, the residents of Rock Springs returned quietly to town and business was resumed. It was November 3, 1910. Mexican-American journalists in the U.S.-Mexico borderlands reported the grisly details of Rodriguez's murder, condemning it as an act of racial terror akin to the lynching of African-Americans in the South. Newspapers in Mexico picked up the story. Lynching is not practiced by the blonde Yankee except upon beings whom, for ethnic reasons, he considers his inferiors, fumed the editors of the Mexico City paper El Debate. Another paper dubbed Anglo-Americans the barbarous whites of the North, deriding them as the giants of the dollar, but pygmies of culture. There is indignation among Mexicans here over this lynching, reported El País. By November 8th, riots had erupted across Mexico, targeting the considerable number of U.S.-owned businesses and homes. The protesters smashed windows and tore down American flags while chanting, "Mueran los Yankees," death to the Americans. The police arrested hundreds of people. In one case, officers drew sabers and descended upon a crowd, killing one man by stabbing him through the neck. The protests continued, on the streets and in the press, prompting Henry Lane Wilson, the U.S. ambassador to Mexico, to issue a public warning. The United States government will leave nothing undone to protect U.S. citizens and property in Mexico. It was a threat. The United States would invade Mexico if attacks on U.S. interests did not cease. The protests raged on. Ambassador Wilson decided to visit General Porfirio Diaz, the dictator of Mexico, to insist that he put a stop to the anti-American disturbances. Porfirio Diaz had ruled Mexico for 27 years, seizing the Mexican presidency by coup d'etat in 1876. The general had thrown open the doors of his country, handing out land and tax incentives to foreign investors. He also guaranteed pliant labor. Tens of thousands of U.S. investors rushed in, ranging from the Rockefellers to one-pick miners, making Mexico the first country where U.S. citizens made significant foreign investment. U.S. citizens soon controlled key sectors of the Mexican economy, railroads, oil, and mining. By 1900, they owned 130 million acres, amounting to one quarter of Mexico's arable land. By 1910, fully half of all money invested by Americans overseas, more than $500 million, went to Mexico, and they expected President Diaz to protect their interests. Diaz used foreign capital to industrialize the Mexican economy, often with little regard for the rights and well-being of Mexico's poorest citizens. when investors bought land claimed by Mexico's rural and indigenous communities. Diaz dispatched soldiers to evict any stragglers or protesters. Most notoriously, when the Yaqui refused to be removed from their homeland, Diaz deported the rebel fighters and their families to labor camps in the jungles of southern Mexico. When industrial workers protested the low wages and dangerous working conditions that prevailed at mines, mills, and factories, Diaz ordered troops to fire on the picket lines. In 1907, during a strike in Rio Blanco, Diaz's troops killed at least 50 picketers on a single morning. And across Mexico, Diaz maintained a deadly mobile strike force, the Rurales, to terrorize his regime's critics. The Rurales killed more than 10,000 people during Diaz's rule. With Diaz in charge, investors brimmed with confidence. Even as protesters filled the streets of Mexico after Antonio Rodriguez's lynching, President Taft quipped to his Secretary of State, "I cannot conceive of a situation in which President Diaz would not act with a strong hand in defense of just American interest." Still, the protests continued. After a week of conflict in the streets, Ambassador Wilson marched into the president's office in the National Palace to lodge a complaint. Diaz cut him off, informing the ambassador that he had already given the press strict orders to stop any further comments on the anti-American demonstrations, and that one of the journals which had disobeyed these instructions, namely El Debate, had been suppressed. When Wilson returned the next day, Diaz informed him that he had given orders to the authorities of the whole republic to act with the necessary energy to suppress any further agitation because of the Texas matter, and that if anything of the kind should happen again, those who participated in any demonstrations would be dealt with all the severity of the law. The Mexican government, Diaz confirmed, would stamp out the protests and censor the press, and everyone involved in the recent disturbances would be brought to account. But the root of the problem was not in Mexico, insisted Diaz. The problem was in the United States. There, across the border region, a large number of Mexicans were living in exile and openly planning a revolution against his rule. As Diaz put it, the riots in Mexico began only because two of those exiles, Francisco Madero and Ricardo Flores Magon, had taken advantage of the unfortunate affair which happened in Texas to excite young students and men of the laboring classes in order to discredit the government. Francisco Madero, one of Mexico's wealthiest men, had been in the United States for just a few months. As recently as June 1910, he had run against Diaz in the presidential election. But Diaz had had him arrested on charges of insulting the president and fomenting rebellion, and held him in custody until the voting was complete and victory declared, securing Diaz's seventh term as the president of Mexico. Madero fled to Texas, where he committed his personal fortune to stockpiling guns and recruiting an insurgent army to force Diaz from power. Ricardo Flores Magon had been in the United States for 6 years, agitating for revolt. His followers, known as magonistas, had few resources. They were poor men and women, mostly miners, farm workers, and cotton pickers, many of them displaced from Mexico when President Diaz gave their land to foreign investors. They wanted their land back, and they were willing to fight for it. For challenging his rule, the Diaz administration dubbed them malos mexicanos, bad Mexicans. By 1910, Ricardo Flores Magon and the Magonistas had launched a series of attacks on the Diaz regime, including 4 armed raids. When Francisco Madero arrived in the United States and called for a mass uprising against Diaz's rule to begin at 6 p.m. on November 20, 1910, the Magonistas vowed to join the fight. By November 16, when Ambassador Wilson met with President Diaz, armed men were mustering on the banks of the Rio Grande. Diaz told Wilson that a revolution was brewing and only the U.S. government could stop it. Unless the American government prevents these men from making an open revolutionary propaganda against the Mexican government, a more serious disturbance might be expected, warned Diaz. U.S. authorities were already monitoring the situation. In Texas, federal agents tailed Francisco Madero, who, they confirmed, was acquiring trainloads of guns and smuggling them across the border. But, according to most U.S. authorities, Madero, a political reformer who was popular among Mexico's middle and upper classes, was not a threat to U.S. interests. After decades of corrupt elections, these wealthier Mexicans sought to oust Diaz from power and restore democratic rule. But they hardly questioned the economic arrangements of the Diaz regime. As Ambassador Wilson put it, a Madero administration would do justice to American interests. U.S. agents did not arrest Madero or his supporters, known as Maderistas. Ricardo Flores Magon and the Magonistas, however, were a threat because they sought a wholesale political and economic revolution. They not only demanded Diaz's ouster, they demanded a strict limit on foreign investment in Mexico, protections for workers, and the return of the land seized by investors during the Diaz era to Mexico's dispossessed rural and indigenous communities. It was the Magonistas who made Tierra y Libertad, Land and Liberty, the revolution's battle cry. This platform was intolerable to U.S. investors and the federal government they strongly influenced. U.S. authorities had been hounding the Magonistas for years, ever since Flores Magon first arrived in the United States in January 1904. Brilliant and ill-tempered, Ricardo Flores Magon looked more like a girthy professor than a gutsy revolutionary. On the pages of his Mexico City newspaper, Regeneración, Flores Magón named the Diaz regime a dictatorship, daring to print a word no one else would. General Diaz has killed democracy, declared Flores Magón. Moreover, he insisted Diaz's economic policies had made Mexicans the servants of foreigners. Diaz had Flores Magon arrested numerous times, his printing press smashed by security forces. After fleeing to the United States in 1904, Flores Magon and his small circle of friends found themselves the target of a joint U.S.-Mexico counterinsurgency campaign. The U.S. Departments of State, War, Justice and Commerce and Labor committed dozens of agents, officers, soldiers, and officials, and enormous resources to undermining the Magonista revolt in the United States. The U.S. Marshals, the Bureau of Investigation, later the FBI, the U.S. Immigration Service, and the Arizona Rangers participated too, as did police and sheriff departments across the country. The U.S. Postal Service played a particularly important role, providing Mexican authorities and agents with access to Magonista mail, which allowed the counterinsurgency units to hunt down revolutionaries on both sides of the border. The Mexican government also hired a bevy of U.S.-based informants and spies and likely paid off at least one U.S. attorney with a diamond ring. In sum, U.S. agents were responsible for monitoring, tracking, arresting, imprisoning, detaining, deporting, and even kidnapping scores of Mexican revolutionaries in the United States, mostly in the borderlands, where the Magonistas maintained a stronghold among the region's Mexican migrant workers. Pressure on the Magonistas was not limited to government authorities. The extra-legal forces of white supremacy also rallied against them. Antonio Rodriguez, the man whose murder in Texas set off the conflagration in Mexico, may have been a Magonista. He was a revolutionist, whispered the residents of Rock Springs, Texas, after they lynched him. Rodriguez, they said, had not only killed a white woman, but was suspected of being one of the many Magonistas known to be traveling the border region, raiding Mexican towns, spreading propaganda, recruiting fighters, and collecting guns for the coming revolt. Against this campaign of coordinated political suppression and racial violence, the Magonistas persevered, outrunning and outsmarting the U.S.-Mexico counterinsurgency team. In 1904, Ricardo Flores Magon and the Magonistas relaunched Regeneración, which they smuggled to tens of thousands of subscribers on both sides of the border. In 1905, they established a political party, the Partido Liberal Mexicano, PLM, to formally challenge Diaz's rule. In 1906, they built an army. By 1908, the PLM army had launched four armed raids on small towns in northern Mexico. The Magonistas then began to cultivate the support of Anglo-American radicals, including the labor organizers Mother Jones and Eugene V. Debs and others, instigating a series of political assaults that deeply wounded Diaz's political standing on the world stage. By 1910, the Magonistas had primed Mexico for revolt. Ricardo Flores Magon and the Magonistas did not go on to lead the revolution's major battles. The PLM's ill-provisioned army lacked the resources needed to lay siege to Diaz. Flores Magon also lacked the will to shift from agitator to military general when the time came to fight, convinced that Mexico's aggrieved masses would spontaneously rise up and storm the dictator's palace once the PLM set the stage for revolt. He was wrong about that. Francisco Madero, Francisco Pancho Villa, Emiliano Zapata, and others took the Mexican Revolution through its fighting phase, but it was Flores Magon and the Magonistas who opened the road to revolution in Mexico. In so doing, they changed the course of history, both north and south of the border. The Mexican Revolution, 1910-17, remade Mexico. In 1917, after 7 years of fighting, Mexico adopted a new constitution that restored democratic rule, asserted public ownership of the subsoil, and increased protections for Mexico's poorest citizens, namely wage owners and communal landholders. Ultimately, most of the Magonistas' demands were enshrined, although not enforced, in the 1917 Constitution. For their role in inspiring the revolt, Ricardo Flores Magon and the Magonistas are widely remembered in Mexico. Historians have anointed them the precursors of the revolution. There are towns, streets, schools, statues, museums, libraries, and even a gym in Mexico named for Flores Magon and the other leaders of the movement. Juan Sabaria, Antonio Villarreal, Enrique Flores Magon, Praxidis Guerrera, and Labrado Rivera. Radicals across Europe and the Americas continue to hold Ricardo Flores Magon in high esteem because he never sacrificed his ideals. Until the day he died, some say he was murdered in a dank cell at Leavenworth Penitentiary. Flores Magon was a rebel. In the 1940s, 20 years after his death, his body was reinterred in Mexico City's Rotunda of Distinguished Men, later renamed the Rotunda of Distinguished Persons, securing his place in Mexican history. The Mexican Revolution also remade the United States. The years of fighting forced more than 1 million Mexicans to flee northward, which radically reoriented U.S. culture, politics, and society by cementing the pathways of mass migration from Mexico and giving rise to the first generation of Mexican Americans. Not even the mass deportation repatriation campaigns executed during the Great Depression could permanently reverse the flow. By 1980, Mexicans had become the largest immigrant group in the United States, ending Europe's long dominance in the U.S. immigration story. By 2010, more immigrants had arrived from Mexico than any other country in U.S. history. Today, Latinos, led by Mexican Americans and Mexican immigrants, constitute the largest non-white population in the United States. By 2045, the United States is projected to be a minority white nation, with Mexican Americans and Mexican immigrants driving the shift. In other words, the 1910 Mexican Revolution is a seminal event in U.S. history. It changed who we are as a people. Yet, few people in the United States know much about the Mexican Revolution, and even less about the men and women who incited it. Typically, the extraordinary story of Ricardo Flores Magon and the Magonistas is folded into the corners of Mexican-American history, which itself is little known in the United States. History textbooks have had little to say on the subject, and until recently, legislators in Arizona all but banned the teaching of Mexican-American studies in K-12 classrooms. Meanwhile, U.S. publishers and film producers persistently struggle to promote Latino voices, content, and experiences. However, as historians of Mexico and the Mexican-American experience have long made clear, you cannot understand U.S. history without Mexico and Mexicans. The history of the United States as a global power cannot be told without Mexico. The U.S. government spent the 19th century charging across the North American continent, launching Indian wars, purchasing European empires, and invading Mexico, all in search of new lands for its white citizens to occupy. Boozed up on the fantasy of manifest destiny, the arriving Anglo-Americans dubbed themselves settlers, and, backed by troops, fought to extinguish indigenous claims to land and life in the region. By the mid-19th century, the U.S. settler state, also branded the White Man's Republic, claimed a massive strip of land from the Atlantic seaboard to the Pacific coast. The United States government and its settler citizens continued their territorial exploits in Hawaii, the Philippines, Puerto Rico, and more. But they also began to seriously consider a new kind of expansion: economic and political domination without territorial acquisition. They began this form of expansion in Mexico, under the rule of Porfirio Diaz, buying land, extracting resources, and using labor without directly assuming control over territory or governance. Then, in 1904, President Theodore Roosevelt issued his corollary to the Monroe Doctrine, which asserted the right and responsibility of the United States to exercise international police power wherever political or economic stability in the Americas seemed threatened. The Diaz regime picked up Roosevelt's big stick, acting as a proxy state to enforce U.S. interests across Latin America. In other words, the expansion of U.S. economic and political might was hatched in Mexico, and from there projected across the Americas, and from there around the world. Diaz's Mexico was the laboratory of U.S. imperialism. Relatedly, the rise of the American West cannot be understood without Mexicans. Foreign investment in Mexico triggered the rise of Mexican labor migration to the United States. Dispossessed in Mexico, millions of Mexicans first migrated within Mexico to towns and cities, factories, haciendas, and mines in search of work. Then they began crossing the border, following the railway lines funded by investors to extract and export Mexico's natural resources. Across the U.S. West, Mexican migrants found plenty of work on the railroads, in copper mines, lumber yards, farms, canneries, and more. By 1920, Mexican labor migrants comprised the American West's single largest low-wage labor force, driving the region's emergence as a global economic powerhouse. But Mexico's labor migrants were not America's immigrants, and their arrival en masse at the beginning of the 20th century opened a new field of race and inequity in the American story. Since the Mexican-American War, 1846-48, Anglo-Americans largely regarded persons of Mexican descent in the United States as conquered, a mixed-race people slotted by manifest destiny to serve settler citizens and fuel their industries, or disappear. Migrating from job to job across the American West, Mexico's labor migrants built the region's industries while running headfirst into a web of white supremacy designed to keep them subservient. They confronted low wages, dangerous working conditions, segregation, and a racially biased immigration enforcement regime, amounting to a system scholars describe as Juan Crow. U.S. settler citizens expected Mexico's labor migrants to bow to the settle order. As Victor S. Clark, the first Anglo-American economist to study Mexican labor migration to the United States, explained in a 1908 report for the Department of Labor, "The Mexican laborer is unambitious, listless, physically weak, irregular, and indolent. On the other hand, he is docile, patient, usually orderly in camp, fairly intelligent under competent supervision, obedient and cheap. If he were active and ambitious, he would be less tractable and would cost more. His strongest point is his willingness to work for a low wage." Victor S. Clark was wrong. Across the American West, Mexico's labor migrants struck for higher wages, challenged the tenets of Juan Crow, and even joined the Magonistas. When they did, the consequences could be brutal. Historians William Kerrigan and Clive Webb have documented that at least 547 Mexicans and Mexican Americans were lynched between 1848 and 1928. They estimated that thousands more were killed without record. Bodies were dumped in the Rio Grande to be swept into the Gulf of Mexico. Corpses were left in the brush to be picked out by crows. Bones were left on the plains to be buried by windstorms. The 1910 killing of Antonio Rodriguez in Rock Springs, Texas, was the 448th such murder on record. No one was arrested. The coroner's report said Rodriguez's body was found, burned to a crisp, lying in the ashes. A local judge ruled that Rodriguez came to his death at the hands of parties unknown. The riots in Mexico that followed Rodriguez's lynching were not merely a protest against yet another incident of racial violence in the United States. They represented a rebellion against the unchecked power of U.S. citizens, namely Anglo-Americans, over Mexican lands and lives in both sides of the border. As one Mexican journalist put it, "We stand between the already special considerations that keep the Yankee on Mexican soil and the degrading, cruel system faced by the Sons of Mexico on the other side of the Rio Bravo, Rio Grande." Migration would provide no escape from their troubles. Fleeing Mexico by moving to the United States, the world's primary receiving country for immigrants at the time, only delivered Mexico's labor migrants deeper into the tangle. Or, as W.E.B. Du Bois, the most trenchant scholar of race working at the time, might have put it, Anglo-Americans had cast a global color line encircling the lives of Mexicans living north and south of the border. The Magonistas were among the first to pose revolution as the only way for Mexico's dispossessed to truly change the conditions of their lives. Once it began, African Americans closely watched the Mexican Revolution. Some even joined it, hoping the insurgents would snap the global color line. The rise of U.S. imperialism, the making of the American West, and rebellion against the color line are just three of the major themes in U.S. history that cannot be understood without Mexico and Mexicans. The Magonistas, numbering no more than a few thousand men and women, many of them undocumented labor migrants, operated at the center of it all, tugging and thrashing at the era's interlocking cords of empire, capitalism, and white supremacy. Their primary target was not the United States, but their uprising, namely their insistence on winning land and liberty in Mexico, imperiled the laboratory of U.S. empire. Their plan to redistribute land and nationalize industries directly threatened U.S. investors. Furthermore, if land in Mexico was redistributed, Mexican labor migrants might return to Mexico and remain there, denying industries across the American West access to a vital source of labor. As such, the Magonistas' revolt threatened key sectors of U.S. society at the turn of the 20th century. U.S. authorities, agents, and settlers mobilized to stop them. In fact, the campaign to crush the Magonistas opened a new chapter of policing in the United States. It was during the search for Ricardo Flores Magon and the Magonistas that the U.S. Department of Justice established the Bureau of Investigation, later renamed the FBI. Stopping the Magonista uprising was one of the FBI's first objectives. In the years ahead, the FBI would grow into a counterinsurgency superforce, suppressing a wide range of radical voices and movements, from the Red Scare to the Black Power movement. In July 1908, just days after the Magonistas launched their most deadly raid on Mexico, the FBI began its work by trying to stop them from inciting a revolution in Mexico that the United States could not control. Despite their importance to the histories of both Mexico and the United States, the Magonistas could have easily been erased from history. Within weeks of arriving in the United States, Ricardo Flores Magon and his friends knew they were being watched. In time, they figured out that agents for the Mexican government were stealing their mail. To thwart the counterinsurgency, the Maganistas lived in hiding, spoke in code, and wrote in cipher. Whenever possible, they burned all evidence of their work. In battle, with their dying breaths, their bellies ripped open by bullets, they gasped out pseudonyms, covering their tracks to the grave. In other words, the Maganistas intentionally left few records behind. But Porfirio Diaz, the dictator whom the Maganistas charged with stealing everything from Mexicans, land, wages, lives, and sovereignty, stole the Maganistas' story, too. His spies stole their letters, his agents cracked their codes, and his functionaries archived it all in Mexico City in the hope that the Maganistas' tell would never escape, never be told. Despite this, the revolution the Maganistas sought to incite was successful, and for decades now, historians of Mexico and the Mexican-American experience have plumbed the dictator's archive to tell their story. Working in English and in Spanish, and even in code, several generations of scholars have been the caretakers of a remarkable history, tending to the Maganista story like a fire in the night. They traveled the world to interview Maganistas and their friends and descendants, and to gather the extensive records documenting the many efforts to suppress their movement. They followed Flores Magon's trail, making photos of everywhere he lived, worked, and hid. They chronicled the journeys of his friends and supporters. They published their findings in dissertations, articles, chapters, websites, and books. In Mexico City, Ricardo Flores Magon's great-grandnephew operates a museum dedicated to the Maganistas, and Professor Jacinto Barrera Basols built an extraordinary digital archive which provides access to many of Flores Magon's letters and other writings. In other words, Porfirio Diaz did not smother the Maganista revolt, and he certainly did not extinguish their legacy. A century on, a living library continues to tell their story. Inspired and informed by that library, this book is about Ricardo Flores Magon and the Maganistas and the cross-border counterinsurgency campaign that failed to stop them. In particular, this book focuses on the U.S. role in the revolt and puts their uprising center stage in American history. The story begins in 19th century Mexico. Long before the insurgency began, with a poor, quiet boy from Oaxaca who would come to hold great power. In his power, which grew under the wing of U.S. empire, lay the origins of the Maganista revolt. Part 1. El Porfiriato. Chapter 1. If We're Not Careful. Porfirio Diaz was just a child when he assembled his first gun and headed to the misty mountains surrounding the small city of Oaxaca to hunt for game. His family was hungry. Porfirio's father, José, had died in the cholera epidemic that swept Mexico in 1833, leaving his mother, Maria, with few resources to raise their seven children on her own. Two of the children died, and Maria was unable to keep up the rent on the beautiful adobe inn she and José had run together. She gave up the keys and moved her kids from a bluff on the edge of town to a small house in the tannery district. The neighborhood had a constant stench. The house was likely simple, a few pieces of wood furniture and no glass in the windows, just canvas covering oversized holes in the wall. Maria barely made ends meet. She made rebozos, shawls, managed a tannery, and grew nopales, cactus pads to sell at the local market. Her children worked, too. They sat with her at the kitchen table adorning rebozos and picked up odd jobs in town, tutoring, carpentry, and so on. Porfirio, her eldest surviving son, a quiet boy known to listen more than he spoke, proved the most clever and enterprising and bold. He learned how to cobble shoes, which he gave to family and sold to friends, and figured out how to assemble functioning guns from parts he found scattered and sold about town, detritus of the country's prior wars. With these guns, he hunted for his family's meals. By the time Porfirio Diaz was born on September 15, 1830, Mexico had been at war for decades and would be at war for decades more. The Mexican War of Independence, 1810-21, a mass insurgency by Mexico's indigenous, black, and mixed-race majority, had ended the Spanish colonial era. However, a small faction of Mexicans, dominated by church leaders and criollos, the Mexican-born descendants of Spanish colonial authorities, held close to the habits of the colonial age. Believing in the deceit of race, the criollos and churchmen argued that a stable and prosperous republic was a racially stratified society and expected that the Spanish colonial racial order, known as the casta system, would continue into the new nation. That system put them, Mexicans of European descent, on top of the social order, followed by mestizos, persons of mixed Spanish and indigenous descent, and other mixed-race persons in the middle, with black and indigenous persons on the bottom. They also wanted to maintain a theocratic state. In a nutshell, the conservatives wanted very little to change. They just wanted to crown themselves the new rulers of Mexico. Mexico's non-white majority refused to comply. Calling themselves liberals, many of Mexico's black, indigenous, and mixed-race communities demanded that the status of citizen rank above all others, especially race, and insisted that the political and economic power of the church be subordinate to that of the state. But the conservatives won control of the first constitutional convention. They made the Catholic Church the fourth branch of government and named a criollo, Agustín de Iturbide, the Emperor of Mexico. The liberals took up arms, ousted Emperor Iturbide, and elected Vicente Guerrero, one of their most noted generals, the first black president in the Americas. The conservatives assassinated Guerrero, sending Mexico into a spiral of conflict, coups, and post-colonial chaos. Between 1830 and 1870, during the first four decades of Porfirio Diaz's life, the Mexican presidency changed hands more than 50 times as liberals and conservatives battled for control. Only two presidents ever finished their term. Some held the office for just a few weeks before the next coup d'etat. Meanwhile, bandits seized control of the nation's roads. They robbed merchants of their cash, goods, and lives, and interrupted trade. Hunger deepened. Infant mortality soared. Life expectancy dropped. Disease spread. Mexico was in crisis. Taking advantage of the tumult in Mexican politics, the United States annexed the Mexican state of Texas in 1845. Unsatisfied by the 172 million acres of new land, Anglo-American settlers, especially slaveholders dreaming of a cotton empire extending all the way to the Pacific, demanded more, prompting President James Polk to order the invasion of Mexico in 1846. Troops soon stormed Mexico City and raised the U.S. flag over the National Palace, forcing Mexico to cede another 336 million acres, more than half of the country's remaining land. At the close of the war in 1848, U.S. treaty negotiators considered seizing even more land, but ultimately decided that acquiring only Mexico's sparsely populated northern territory would balance the settlers' hunger for new real estate with their disinclination to incorporate a large number of Mexican people, whom Anglo-Americans generally disparaged as mongrels, unfit for U.S. citizenship. As John O'Sullivan, the journalist who coined the term Manifest Destiny, later warned, the annexation of the country, Mexico, to the United States would be a calamity. 5 million ignorant and indolent half-civilized Indians, with 1.5 million free Negroes and mulattoes, would scarcely be a desirable encumbrance, even with the great natural wealth of Mexico. Senator Louis Cass of Michigan agreed. We do not want the people of Mexico, either as citizens or subjects. All we want is a portion of territory which they hold, generally uninhabited, or where inhabited at all, sparsely so. Drawn down the valley of the Rio Grande River and out west to the Pacific Ocean, the new U.S.-Mexico border was a 2,000-mile color line between what many Anglo-Americans regarded as white America and mongrel Mexico. Amid the upheaval of life and politics in 19th-century Mexico, Maria, a mestiza, tried to put her sons on a steady and secure path, sending Porfirio and his younger brother Felix to seminary in the hope that they would become priests. As priests, their fate would be linked to that of the Catholic Church, the single largest institution in Mexico. During the colonial period, the Spanish crown had granted large swaths of indigenous land to the church. On that land, the church erected buildings and launched commercial enterprises, ranging from agriculture to textiles. The War of Independence ousted Spanish governors, but the Catholic Church retained most of its properties and its power. Maria, a devout Catholic herself, tried to insulate her boys within the walls of the church's enduring privileges. As priests, Porfirio and Felix would at least always have somewhere to live and something to eat. Porfirio was not a strong student. He never learned to spell well, and his presidential archive is strewn with errors. A lifelong fitness fanatic, he preferred to spend his time working out. When he got his hands on one of the first workout books to arrive in Oaxaca, he used it to build an improvised gym for himself and Felix. The brothers also spent countless hours swimming in the local rivers. When the United States invaded Mexico in 1846, Porfirio trained with a youth militia, but was never sent to join the fighting. 3 years later, at the age of 19, just before he was due to graduate and begin his life as a parish priest, Porfirio, the young hunter and fitness fiend, dropped out of seminary and joined the liberal faction in Mexico's ongoing domestic conflict. It was a decision that put him on the path to war, fame, and ultimately the presidency. Two men inspired Porfirio Diaz to join the liberal faction. Professor Marcos Perez, one of Mexico's leading liberal intellectuals, taught at the Institute of Arts and Sciences in Oaxaca. When Perez hired Diaz to tutor his son, Diaz began spending time in the Perez home. There, he overheard Professor Perez rail against the vestiges of Spanish colonialism in modern Mexican life, especially the unbroken power of the Catholic Church. Fetes, once a seminary student himself, noted Diaz's curiosity and began to mentor the young mestizo seminarian in the liberal tradition. Fetes also introduced Diaz to Benito Juarez, the esteemed governor of Oaxaca. Like Diaz, Juarez had been born with little, an orphaned Zapotec boy from the mountains surrounding the city of Oaxaca. Juarez became the first indigenous lawyer in Mexico and built a successful career representing native clients while also entering politics, ascending from city council to governor in just a few years. When Fetes took Diaz to meet Juarez at an opulent event held at the Institute, Diaz was mesmerized by their encounter. As he would recall many years later, Juarez spoke to the students as friends and as men who had rights, exhibiting a culture of openness and frankness to which the seminary student was not accustomed. Roused to liberalism by Fetes, Juarez, and their spirit of equity, Diaz quit the seminary and signed up for law school at the Institute. He remained a poor student, preferring calisthenics to academics, but he was astute, charismatic, and determined, a cocktail of traits that made him a favored student. Fetes and Juarez kept him close. In 1853, when General Antonio López de Santa Anna, a legendary figure, ascended to power with the conservatives, Diaz joined them in revolt. No one man contributed more to Mexico's political tumult than the one-legged Santa Anna. More opportunist than ideologue, Santa Anna was a crafty military man who fought for and against the Spanish during the War of Independence, for and against Emperor Iturbide during his rule, and for and against the liberals and the conservatives thereafter. Willing to tack with the winds of power, Santa Anna seized and lost the Mexican presidency 11 times between 1833 and 1853. In 1853, Santa Anna launched his final coup d'etat. With the support of the conservatives, he seized the presidency and then declared himself the Emperor of Mexico, naming himself Su Alteza Serenissima, His Most Serene Highness. The liberal faction rebelled. Marcos Fetes penned stinging rebukes. Benito Juarez organized a guerrilla army. Porfirio Diaz ventured into the mountains surrounding the city of Oaxaca to muster a unit of Zapotec Indians. He showed them how to assemble guns and taught them the military drills he had learned in his youth militia at the time of the U.S. invasion. He also built a gym, giving free membership to all men who vowed to fight and guiding them in exercises to improve their strength and stamina. Within the year, Juarez's liberal army, supported by Diaz's Zapotec unit, removed General Santa Anna from office and seized control of the government. With Juarez at their head, the liberals wasted no time in pressing Mexico toward the future they had imagined. In 1855, the Liberal Congress adopted the Ley Juarez, ending the church's judicial privilege, which had protected the church and its personnel from civil and criminal prosecution in secular courts. In 1856, they adopted the Ley Lerdo, which banned corporate land ownership. In 1857, they elected Benito Juarez president and rewrote the Constitution. Drafted by Ponciano Arriaga, another leading liberal of the era, the 1857 Constitution ended the Catholic Church's status as the nation's official religion, guaranteed equal political rights to all men, banned corporate land ownership, and prohibited the president from running for re-election. The adoption of this Constitution was the liberals' proudest achievement It infuriated the Catholic Church and the nation's conservatives, triggering an explosive civil conflict which historians call the Reform War, 1857 to 61. During the Reform War, President Juarez appointed Porfirio Diaz to serve as a captain in the infantry. Diaz proved to be a shrewd military strategist, commanding his troops in a series of unlikely victories as when he lured better-armed conservatives into a ravine, then buried them in a storm of rocks and boulders pushed from the cliff above by unarmed Zapotecas and campesinos. Noting the ingenuity and bravery of his old pupil, Juarez promoted Diaz to the rank of military commander and governor of Tehuantepec, a region of eastern Oaxaca, famed for its hostility to outsiders as well as its internal ethnic divisions. In Tehuantepec, Diaz honed his gift for politics. He won compliance from local elites by retiring the practice of forcing village leaders to pay additional taxes to fund the war. But he also sowed dissension among them, creating space for himself to step in and resolve disputes. When patronage and arbitrage failed to win him loyalty, Diaz could be cruel. He slaughtered those known to harbor conservatives, explaining the violence as unfortunate but necessary. The human heart is guided more by fear than by any other emotion, he explained. And so in order to demoralize the enemy, exemplary actions, carried out with energy and rigor, were indispensable, even if they might be subsequently regretted. In the decades ahead, Diaz would often speak about the regret that follows violence. He would weep over the deaths of enemies and innocents alike, but he would slaughter all the same. As Benito Juarez later warned about his protege, "If we're not careful, Porfirio could kill us while crying." When the liberals won the Reform War in 1861, Juarez retook the presidency, determined to implement the liberal vision for life in Mexico. But he soon learned how much the decades of coups, disease, invasion, and tumult had cost the treasury. Mexico was broke, drowning in $80 million of international debt. Juarez announced that Mexico would suspend payments on the debt for 2 years. His goal was to buy enough time to establish a new tax and revenue system, allowing Mexico to pay off its European creditors without bankrupting the treasury. The debt moratorium proved to be a political disaster. Since the ousting of Emperor Iturbide, a small group of Mexican criollos had regretted the War of Independence. They had hoped that independence would allow a domestic elite of Mexicans of European descent to seize full political and economic control of Mexico. But with the rise of the liberals, the nation's indigenous, black, and mixed-race majority upended their plan. For decades, Mexican criollos had visited the royal courts of Europe, begging a monarch to occupy Mexico, protect their properties, defend the Catholic Church, and enforce the colonial social order. They wanted a white empire to rule in Mexico. Few European monarchs wanted anything to do with a criollo's plan. Mexico was a political quagmire. Decades earlier, in 1823, the United States government had issued its Monroe Doctrine, vowing to protect any independent nation in the Americas from European colonization. Invading Mexico was thus tantamount to invading the United States. No one in Europe was willing to test the hemisphere's most powerful republic. No one except Louis Napoleon Bonaparte, who, in 1848, seized the French presidency and convinced the French Congress to name him emperor. He titled himself Napoleon III, after his uncle Napoleon I, known as Napoleon the Great. Napoleon III dreamed of rebuilding the French Empire in the Americas. The 1763 Treaty of Paris had forced France to cede most of its territories in North America. Then, in 1803, Napoleon I sold the sprawling Louisiana Territory to the United States, relinquishing France's last major Northern American holding. The next year, in 1804, enslaved Africans in the French colony of Saint-Domingue, Haiti, finished a decades-long revolt by killing off slaveholders, ousting French authorities, and declaring Haiti an independent republic. By the 1820s, the French Empire was effectively over. For years, Napoleon III pored over maps of Mexico while chain-smoking and plotting the resurrection of the French Empire in the Americas. While he waited for an opportunity to strike, Benito Juarez defaulted on Mexico's international debt. A few weeks later, the United States erupted in civil war. The timing seemed perfect. Juarez's debt moratorium presented a pretext to invade Mexico, while the Civil War lowered the protective shield around the Americas that the Monroe Doctrine had raised. The situation in the United States is very favorable, Napoleon III observed from Paris. In April 1862, with Union and Confederate forces battling at Shiloh and New Orleans, Napoleon III dispatched French troops to invade Mexico and recruited the Austrian Archduke Ferdinand Maximilian Joseph Maria von Habsburg Lothringen, a young royal with no country to rule, to serve as the titular head of the French invasion of Mexico. Napoleon III named the Austrian Archduke Emperor Maximilian. From the port of Veracruz, French troops marched across mountain roads and jungle paths to Mexico City. The conservatives welcomed them at every stop. Juarez's guerrilla fighters harassed them, but the better-provisioned French troops pushed on. By May 5, 1862, they had arrived in the town of Puebla, their last stop before Mexico City. Armed with little more than the old brown Bessies left behind by U.S. troops during their invasion 14 years before, General Diaz's Zapotec unit stopped them. French troops gathered on a small hill outside Puebla, their new guns glinting in the sun. At noon, the 1st French Battalion stormed the main road into Puebla. Two further battalions attacked from the east and the west, raining cannon fire on the nearly 6,000 liberal soldiers pinned between them. Soon, only Diaz's unit was left, stationed in a church in the center of town. As French soldiers poured into Puebla, Diaz and his squadron burst from the church into hand-to-hand combat. Within minutes, 253 men were killed, 436 were wounded. But Diaz's troops kept fighting for hours. A woman named Margarita Magon brought water to the fighters. Among them, she met Teodoro Flores, with whom she would later have three sons, who in time would become some of General Diaz's most vocal critics. But on this day, long before their boys were born, Margarita Magon and Teodoro Flores fought side by side with Diaz to stop the French troops from reaching Mexico City. Eventually, the French forces were chased out of Puebla, closing the door to the Mexican capital. As the general in charge of the campaign later admitted, it was Diaz and his fighters who drove off the French troops, con empeño y bizarría, with determination and bravery. The triumph at Puebla made Porfirio Diaz a legend. Proud officials in Oaxaca gifted him a massive ranch, La Noria. His family would never again live in poverty. The world marveled at the mestizo general who had led Zapotec fighters to victory against Napoleon's army. The victory is still commemorated. We call it Cinco de Mayo. The liberal triumph at Puebla re-energized the Mexican resistance. In 1867, liberal forces ended the French occupation, humiliating Napoleon III and sending a stunned Maximilian to a firing squad and his wife, Empress Carlota, to a madhouse. After ousting the French, Porfirio Diaz emerged alongside Benito Juarez as one of Mexico's most revered liberal leaders, even though liberalism was a rather loose concept for him. Whereas Juarez toiled over the finer details of liberal philosophy and governance, often citing obscure laws and ancient texts in debates over the day-to-day architecture of equality, Diaz was more pragmatic. He derided Juarez's Talmudic pondering as profundismo. Diaz had an agile, clever mind, but he preferred deeds to words. He would never be a strong public speaker. He spent a few unremarkable years in Congress, accomplishing little as a legislator. But with nearly two decades of battlefield experience, he had become a ruthless tactician. His brand of liberalism was bare-knuckled and broad, a belief in racial equality, a commitment to secularizing the Catholic Church, and a general defense of the liberals' cardinal achievement, the 1857 Constitution, beginning with its ban on presidential reelection, which allowed Diaz to challenge Juarez for the presidency. In 1867, Juarez ran for his third term as the president of Mexico, a clear violation of the Constitution. Diaz ran against him with "no reelection" as his campaign slogan. But Juarez was too popular to unseat. Additionally, he had taken the precaution of replacing political opponents in key governorships, who in turn appointed jefes políticos, regional administrators, who appointed electors who voted in favor of Juarez. Diaz lost the election, having learned one final lesson from his mentor. Political machinery can easily be manipulated to maintain political power. Diaz retreated to La Noria, where he married his 21-year-old niece and experimented with his home-built munitions factory. In 1871, Porfirio Diaz again challenged Benito Juarez, and again he lost. This time, Diaz responded to his electoral loss with an armed revolt. Throughout the revolt, Diaz spent much of his time in Brownsville, Texas, rallying political and financial support for his coup among Mexican exiles and U.S. industrialists. He tasked his brother Felix with leading the troops in Mexico. The military campaign quickly collapsed, especially as Felix failed to gauge how much Zapotec fighters in Oaxaca despised him for an incident that occurred the year before the revolt began, when Felix, while serving as governor of Oaxaca, participated in an attack on the village of Juchitan. After setting fire to the village and killing many of the men, Felix knocked down a wooden statue of the village's patron saint and, in front of the survivors, burned it. With Felix at the helm of Diaz's troops, many Zapotecs chose to fight for Juarez. Villagers from Juchitan specifically targeted Felix. When they found him, they shaved the skin from the soles of his feet and forced him to march several miles to his own execution, then cut off his feet before they killed him. Felix's gruesome murder shook his brother Porfirio. The two had always been close. but Diaz kept fighting. When Juarez died a natural death in office, Diaz saw that he had no political choice but to call off the coup and allowed Juarez's vice president, Sebastian Lerdo de Tejada, to take office without opposition. 4 years later, in 1876, when President Lerdo de Tejada ran for the office he had inherited, Diaz led another coup in protest at what he saw as Lerdo's re-election campaign. This time, he remained in Mexico to personally lead his supporters. Teodoro Flores and other veterans joined the insurgency, which Diaz called El Plan de Tuxtepec. The experienced comrades defeated the National Army and forced Lerdo de Tejada from office, allowing Diaz to seize control of the federal government under the liberal banner of no re-election. General Porfirio Diaz ruled Mexico with an iron fist for the next 35 years. Chapter 2. Order and Progress. Early in Diaz's rule, a group of merchants growing rich on smuggled goods resisted his efforts to suppress the bandit economy. Diaz, it is often said, ordered the local authorities to kill them, the merchants, in cold blood. It is an apocryphal story about Diaz's harsh rule, but even Diaz described his methods as harsh to the point of cruelty. Still, he had many supporters who objected neither to the bloodshed nor to his increasingly autocratic ways. After decades of civil war, two foreign invasions, countless epidemics, and generations of crippling debt, they were exhausted. As one of Diaz's defenders put it, "Rights, society now rejects them. What it wants is bread. We have already enacted innumerable rights which produce only distress and malaise in society. Now let us try a little tyranny, but honorable tyranny, and see what result it brings." Under Diaz's honorable tyranny, there were no more coups, no more invasions. The bandit economy was suppressed. Public health improved, literacy rose, electricity began to flicker on in the cities. During his more than three-decade rule, a period known as the Porfiriato, Diaz successfully brought what he called order and progress to Mexico. But it came at a cost. Diaz draped his rule in a veil of democracy. In 1880, when his first four-year term was up, he stepped down and maneuvered his close friend Manuel González into the presidency. It was a puppet regime, and everybody knew it, but Diaz had formally complied with the 1857 Constitution's ban on presidential re-election. In 1884, Diaz ran for president again, asserting that non-successive rule did not equate with re-election. He won the 1884 election and quickly convinced Congress to amend the Constitution in order to allow for one consecutive re-election. In 1888, he was elected president again and then urged Congress to remove the constitutional ban on re-election entirely. Congress, a toothless body that Diaz called his herd of tame horses, yielded. Meanwhile, Diaz fostered a cult of personality that positioned him to be drafted into candidacy by groups of adoring citizens such as the Society of Friends of the President and the National Porfirian Circle. As Diaz stated to a curated crowd at the start of his 1892 presidential campaign, "I do not expect gentlemen, much less allow myself, to presume that my fellow citizens will honor me with an electoral majority once again. I feel quite satisfied that I have fulfilled the sovereign mandate over two consecutive constitutional periods, but I would never fail to obey if another period were imposed upon me legally. He won the next five elections, 1892, 1896, 1900, 1904, and 1910. As the years passed, the election fraud grew increasingly bold. Ballot boxes went missing. Police lined up voters and directed their votes. Opposition candidates were jailed or worse. Those who spoke out against Diaz's rule were subject to arrest. Since Diaz had cajoled Congress in 1882 to broaden the definition of libel to include criticism of government authorities, Diaz also dispatched the rurales to quiet dissenting voices. Armed and mounted, the rurales roamed the country, executing Diaz's enemies. They often shot their victims in the back, a technique permitted under the ley fuga, the law of flight, which the historian Paul J. Vanderwerd describes as Mexico's version of lynch law. Diaz would unleash the ley fuga with a simple word, severely. To punish offenders, severely, explains the historian Paul Garner, was Diaz's euphemism for execution. As many as 10,000 people died under declarations of the ley fuga. Violence, however, was rarely Diaz's first choice. He preferred rule by patronage, arbitration, and benevolence. Using the political scheme he learned from Benito Juarez, Diaz yoked nearly all political appointments to his person so that his approval was required to win any public office in Mexico. "Candidates should be more or less friends of mine," he once said. Among the most powerful positions in the Diaz regime was that of jefe político, often reporting directly to Diaz. A jefe político was responsible for overseeing almost all areas of governance within a given jurisdiction. Taxes, elections, police, jails, roads, and so on. Jefes políticos were not paid much, but in return for fixing elections, enforcing decrees, and impressing soldiers, Diaz granted them a rapacious and profitable autonomy. As the historian Alan Knight explains, jefes políticos in Chihuahua accumulated personal fortunes by fining campesinos for letting their burros sip from public streams. In Guanajuato, they fined indigenous persons for entering town limits wearing the traditional baggy pants. In the Yucatan, they took endless kickbacks from plantation owners. In Sonora, they skimmed off land from campesinos. Everywhere, jefes políticos forced girls and women into various degrees of sexual slavery. The jefe político system, known as the jefatura, was one of the primary methods by which Diaz centralized political power. When the Mexican Revolution finally began in 1910, many fighters, men and women, mothers and fathers, husbands and wives, and entire communities took up arms to end the sexual abuses perpetrated by jefes políticos. Sitting atop the nation's political machinery, Diaz positioned himself as the final arbiter of everything. From local elections to labor strikes, he woke every morning at 6 a.m. and took a bath before dedicating several hours to answering correspondence and reading a number of newspapers, sometimes noted with pencil some of the most striking passages. He followed this morning ritual with another round of letter writing with his cadre of personal secretaries. Together, they replied to every letter that arrived in his office, more than 1 million of them recorded during his rule. Without regard to class or race, using everyone as an opportunity to settle a disagreement, solve a problem, and sometimes to bestow a small favor or gift, such as a signed portrait of the president. As Diaz once put it, "Even if an individual may appear to be useless, literally a corpse or a cadaver, that should not be a reason for us to be indifferent to the potential help he might give us. When it is a question of attempting to extend the influence of a party or campaign, every offer of help should be welcomed." In homes across Mexico, a drawer held a letter from the president. While building his political machine, Diaz used his second marriage to bury some of the nation's oldest political tensions. In 1879, his first wife and niece died after giving birth to their sixth child, a baby girl who died after taking just a few breaths. Only two of their children survived. The others died young, often in infancy, and almost certainly from congenital conditions. In 1880, Diaz met Carmen Romero Rubin at a party in the Mexico City home of the U.S. ambassador. The deeply religious daughter of a wealthy family in the Mexican North, she was 17 years old, U.S. educated and European descended. Smitten, Diaz asked her to marry him. She agreed, taking as her husband the 51-year-old general, a poor son of a widowed mestiza from the southern state of Oaxaca. This domestic union symbolically united Mexico. Young and old, north and south, poor and rich, criollo and mestizo, as well as church and state, as the old liberal general conceded to a civil ceremony followed by a Catholic mass. Carmen also helped Diaz to smooth Mexico's relationship with its northern neighbor, which had been fraught ever since the U.S. invasion of Mexico. They honeymooned in the United States, visiting New Orleans, New York, Washington, D.C., and St. Louis. Throughout the trip, Carmen remained at her husband's side, translating his words as they dined and chatted with Anglo-American elites. As Diaz's chosen biographer would later...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.